Hello and welcome to another episode of A Historian Plays, Assassin's Creed Chronicles China. This is the third episode. I'm going to be doing this just for today because I accidentally released two videos last week, one of which was supposed to come out this week. I'm hoping to change up this series a little bit. More on that later. Anyways, let's get into the game.
Pose them into slavery. I have located the box, Xiaojun. It's in the possession of Yu Deyong, another of Zhang Yong's tigers, the one they call the Slaver.
So he is responsible for this cruelty. I shall pay him a visit.
Tread lightly, sister. The Templars are searching all ships and cargo. They are looking for us now. I know you can kill these lesser men with ease, but I would suggest you remain invisible. A ghost, until you find your target.
And here we go. Anytime now. Alrighty then. So for those who didn't see the last episode, or the episode before that, I've been using this to more talk about the theory around how this depiction of the Orient is. The Orient being things that are east of Europe. Specifically the theory called Orientalism. Now, last time, I went pretty deep into what Orientalism is and what cultural hegemony is. This time, though, we're going to be going into more things of what's called post-colonialism. Of course, Orientalism is technically post-colonialism. A lot of sneaking around in this game. A lot of waiting. So for a quick refresher of what it was about last time, Orientalism is that idea of essentializing foreign cultures, making them into these kinds of things that don't change over time, that there are these antiquated cultures that, you know, are cute in comparison to the West. If you think about The Last Samurai, that's a pretty good example of Orientalism in action, even in Hollywood movies that are supposed to be, you know, nice depictions. Ultimately, they play into Empire and justifying Empire as being a good thing. You know, because it's such an antiquated culture that, you know, we're perfectly okay with taking over some old culture to, you know, bring them into the modern world. It's somewhat despicable, but ultimately something that is all too commonplace. Then we also talked about cultural hegemony, which was, which is basically when some culture is able to maintain hegemony over another. So think about how the British were able to maintain their righteousness over the Indians after the Sepoy Rebellion of 1856. It's kind of hard to talk over all this Chinese. It's kind of distracting. This game keeps on introducing interesting new ways of hiding. Like, if you have these green things, you can go jump inside them, but if you move, they see your movements. So yeah, I have to sit there while they move away. I'll find towards the end of this, I give up and end up just slaughtering everyone, because that's what you do in a video game. You just kill people left and right, even if you're supposed to be sneaking around.
So
yeah, cultural hegemony is the idea that ultimately there is some sort of overarching culture that has the final say of what's right or wrong. One might even be able to say that the most hegemonic culture of them all currently is the American culture, which, well, I'm probably playing into it, but, you know, that's the whole thing about cultural hegemony. It's kind of inescapable. So, last time, what I was getting at was the idea of the subaltern. Because there's this whole series of things called subaltern studies, which this kind of is trying to be a part of. You know, this figure that could never have made it into the history books. That's basically what the subaltern is somebody underrepresented in history. Now, it doesn't quite apply to, you know, race, class, and gender stuff, where, you know, the old white guys who have ruled everything are now kind of being usurped because big man history is no longer a big thing in history programs. But more,
I need to get his attention elsewhere.
More of the folks that don't get represented at all. Those who are only mentioned or never have any written sources. So, like, women in the 19th century in America don't really count. But, American Indians, on the other hand. Oh, and here I go. I just said, screw it. I'll just kill everyone. And you just keep hurting them, and they always have ranged weapons, but you can go and hide, and then they just go, I know he's somewhere over there. Funny thing about stealth games. They know exactly where you are, and they just go, don't know anything. Getting back on subject. And have fun in there. But getting back on subject, folks like Native Americans or American Indians are perhaps in the subaltern, especially when the only people writing about them are folks like, you know, fur traders and Indian department officials and whatnot, you know. Somebody who is not a representative of that particular group of people. So, the example that started getting a lot of press attention back in the 80s were Indian women in the early 19th century, right before the Sepoy Rebellion, because one of the things that Britain used to justify their empire in India was the practice, and I'm going to forget the word right now, of course, but the practice in which wives of men who had died, aka widows, would burn themselves along with their husband's corpse. So they would literally self-immolate themselves. Now, there's a lot of debate as to how prominent of a custom that actually was, and all that kind of thing. But the fact is, it is known to have happened, and the British used that to justify their hegemony. Not only cultural hegemony, as in we are the right culture and anything else is below us, but also actual hegemony, as in they literally ruled India. And the same could be said of China that this game is about, only a few centuries later. Of course, at this time, this is during the heyday of the Ming Empire, who, were actually Han Chinese. They had been ruling China for almost a century by this point. Because, as I might remind you, this is supposed to happen in 1526, if I remember correctly. So, the main character could be considered part of the subaltern. You know, the people who would never have made it into the history books, who never would have had any kind of writing of their own. Because, after all, the sad fact is, history must be based upon the written record. So, if you're not writing, you don't get to be part of history. Cultures that are prior to writing are called prehistoric. It's the nature of the profession. Oh, that guy spotted me, and now I'm just gonna climb on down and hide down there, and then just not gonna even notice. Well, okay, he noticed, but then does nothing. I'll literally just sit here, I think. Oh. Yep, there you go. Over there, nobody's like, oh, maybe I should go check it out. Man, gotta wait. Kinda sucks. And whee! So, this gal named Gayatri Spivak. Probably butchering that name as well, because she's Indian, and I was a substitute at one point, so butchering names is kind of my thing. Anyways, she wrote this very important paper called Does the Subaltern Speak? And the question was about those Indian women that I mentioned before, you know, the ones who self-immolated after they had become widows. And ultimately saying that we can't get at these narratives, because there was this growing thing trying to say that there's ways of representing these people without the writing to back it up. So there's this really interesting thing to elucidate those narratives that people haven't been able to show because there's just not enough writing on it. There's a whole lot of techniques around it, and it's just called subaltern studies. It's a form of post-colonialism, and probably the most prominent form. It's a whole bunch of different people who can be said to be post-colonialist historians and philosophers and all that kind of stuff. The main idea is to show how colonialism has affected history and bring out narratives that otherwise wouldn't have been possible before. Of course, this game isn't a commentary on that in the slightest. If anything, it plays into what they are fighting against, namely narratives that cannot be shown Ooh, that was a close one. Narratives that can't be shown simply because there's no writing on it, and this game completely plays in the dark. You know, it's Assassin's Creed, so it's this world conspiracy that's supposed to know about. Of course. Oh yeah, and you can't swim in this, by the way. You fall in the water, you die. But the I had trouble figuring out where to go from here. And I start getting attacked, and I'm just gonna fight my way through for the rest of it, I believe. It's always funny how it shows somebody else getting, you know, brutalized. Like, hey, don't get screwed over like this guy. So yeah, it's a interesting theory that a lot of historians will mention when speaking about how, you know, the whole idea that, like, the victors write the history, that the idea that the subaltern literally can't speak because they're not, you know, well enough written about, and there are those who are not even in the subaltern, but simply in a subjected culture that the hegemonic culture ultimately has control of. That's actually a place where you could say victors write the history. But it's very different from how a lot of people talk about that. I'd like to make an episode about these things in full. Rather than just speaking about them. The problem is I have to come up with enough pictures in that to edit together an episode. So this brings me to how I want to rephrase this series. Hopefully those who stuck around are still paying attention and all that. So this series has been mostly just me commenting live on a video game that I'm playing. But I want to kind of rephrase it and talk more about historical theories. Things like post-colonialism and that. And I wouldn't otherwise be able to make an episode about because I just don't have enough material visually to edit together. So the idea is to, and here I go. It's just get out of my way. And notice that they all attack one on one, so you don't have to worry about being attacked from all sides. And eventually you regenerate health as well. But anyways, the ammo. Calling throwing stars in that ammunition. But I want to rebrand this series so that I'm not doing live commentary. I want to basically just use video games as, like, background. Something where I have an actual written episode in that. But I use just video games as something visual in the background. Of course, they remain historical video games, and maybe I'll put some text on the screen, kind of laughing at something happening in the video game. But in terms of direct commentary about the game or anything along those lines, wouldn't be the point of the series to be talking about the historical theories, like post-colonialism, like I began this episode with. But I don't quite know how to name it or brand it or whatever, so if you guys have any If you guys have any suggestions, please tell me in the comments. I'm really interested in figuring out how to do this, because there's a lot of stuff that I could talk about this way and not really have to do all the video editing on this stuff, because you have to understand, for every minute of episode, there's probably at least an hour of video editing in and of itself, plus all the research and writing that I do, which is much, much more. And that's the part I'd much rather focus on, is the research and writing, rather than the visual aspect. Because after all, I'm a historian, not a video editor. I've become a video editor because of this whole channel.
But
it still takes a lot of time.
当然是刺客，要是他们回来了，难道不会攻击这座要塞吗？要是他们回来了，那可真是有够蠢的。
I think anybody who plays this game cares about what they're actually saying. They just wait for them to shut up so that they can move on.
当然是刺客，要是他们回来了，难道不会攻击这座要塞吗？
Repeating themselves.
要是他们回来了，那可真是有够蠢的。
Sure hope an assassin won't attack this place. That would be embarrassing.
Gun!
What? There's a person there, and I don't know anymore. Yeah, that's the basic idea of rebranding this whole series. So I'm gonna cut this episode short. I don't think anybody really needs to, really wants to know how this whole part goes. Was more interested in the historical theory in that. And that's one I want to focus on in the future. So be sure to leave a comment on how you think that could work. I really want to do it. Oh, and there I go dying, because I thought I could jump on that. You can cut these strings with your throwing knives. And see, it moves the boat into place. Ta-da! Puzzles. You basically have to kill this dude. Really no choice in the matter. There's a way to do these things entirely without killing, but it's kind of difficult. It's a higher skill level. Anyways, that being said, I think that's enough for now. It's been something like 20 minutes. So be sure to tell me what you think, and I guess I will see you all next week with another California episode. The first one was supposed to come out this week, and that's why I'm putting this out today. So I'll see you all then. Bye.
Good. 来帮忙! 报上名来。
他们跑哪儿去了？
，站住！有入侵者！这边，我们在等你现身。
A little distraction could help me.
就是那座桥吗？ 怎么回事啊？ 这里。
Yeah.